So, as a Linux policy administration, the basics, security models, another very important concept when it comes to understanding SE Linux. So, security models are models that SE Linux uses to address common challenges. Jesus Christ. The lawnmower you hear in the background. So, those are models that SE Linux uses, or can use actually, to address common challenges. And I say can use because not every model is used by SE Linux by default. So, previously we discussed some of the things that SE Linux tries to address. For example, SE Linux complements the traditional Linux security, traditional identity-based discretionary access control. But how do you do that? How do you implement SE Linux to complement traditional Linux security? Well, there's actually a security model that deals with that question, that deals with that issue. How do you enforce integrity, fine-grained mandatory access control? How do you enforce integrity? There's actually various security models that deal with various aspects of enforcing integrity. How do you optionally enforce confidentiality? Well, there's an optional security model that actually deals with enforcing confidentiality, that basically makes that possible. And how do you deal? How do you optionally enforce compartmentalization? Well, there's another optional security model that enables that, that deals with that. So, there are currently six common security models, of which three are default security models, so those are always there, and another three that are optional security models. Those are optional, and those aren't always there, but you can basically enable them if the default security models are not suffice for your particular need. So let's mention also that the flexible and flexible, configurable and open nature of SE Linux allows for the design and implementation of additional security models, optional security models. So if one of the six common security models doesn't address a particular challenge that you have, then the flexible, configurable and open nature of SE Linux allows you to design your own and implement your own additional optional security model to address that particular challenge. And that's an important part of SE Linux. That's what it allows, an important plus, so to speak. So let's look a little bit deeper into those different security models that SE Linux can use. So one of the three default security models that SE Linux uses is called a identity-based access control security model, abbreviated IBAC. And this is a special security model because this security model actually deals with the issue of complementing traditional Linux security. This security model basically acts as a glue between SE Linux and identity-based access control. And the way that works is that the identity-based access control security model provides us with a security identity security attribute that we can use to create and associate identity security identifiers to processes. And we can use that identity security identifier to associate SE Linux to traditional Linux security. And we'll get into more detail about that later, but just know that identity-based access control and identity security identifiers are a way, are there to basically, mainly by default, are there to basically create an association between SELinux and traditional Linux security. It's a bridge, building a bridge between SELinux and Linux security. I don't have time right now. So, how does that work? So, basically, here it says associate IBAC identity security identifiers to traditional Linux security user identities and group identities. So, we discussed user identity identifiers and group identity identifiers from in a traditional Linux security world, and basically, SELinux has identity security identifiers as well. And those are used to basically create an association between the two. So, how that works is that SELinux associates what's called role-based access control role security identifiers to identity-based access control identity security identifiers, and it does the same for MLS security sensitivity security identifiers. And MCS category security identifiers. Now we haven't talked yet about we haven't yet explained the role-based access control security model and the MLS security model and the MCS security model. Just know that SELinux or the identity-based access control security model is a glue between SELinux and traditional Linux security, but more closely, or more particularly, a glue between the various SELinux security models and traditional Linux security model. So we'll get into this later, just for reference for now. And IBAC can also be used, additionally, be used to determine whether identity security identifiers can change. So there are some optional using additional policy constraints and access factors provided by access by object managers. So optionally, or actually not optionally, but additionally, the identity security identifiers are used to determine whether an identity security identifier can change to another one using what's called policy constraints. We'll get into that later. And using the access factors, which we already discussed to some extent, provided by object managers. So the combination of constraints and access factors allow us to specify whether one identity security identifier can change manually change to another. So that's IBAC, identity-based access control. It's basically the bridge between SELinux and traditional Linux security. And that's why it's a special security model, because it doesn't actually, well, it actually does do access control, but in a strange way. It just it's basically more an association thing. So another default security model is the role-based access control security model, abbreviated RBAC. And the challenge that RBAC addresses is that it basically allows us to govern access to one or more TE-type security identifiers using role-based access control role security identifiers. So how this works is that I'm not sure, you're probably not familiar with role-based access control, but role-based access control basically are ways to assign tasks to users, sets of tasks to users. So, for example, a web administrator could be assigned to the web administrator role, and the web administrator role has all the permissions you need to just manage the web server, or yeah, and related stuff. And that's a role. It's a particular ro a role that deals with a particular task. SELinux allows you to do that using the type enforcement security model. So basically, role-based access control allows you to build a bridge It's basically a bridge between type enforcement and allowing role users to allowing us to associate roles to users using identity-based access control. So the way that works, that is, associate role-based role security identifies to identity-based security identifies. So there's the bridge that IBAC aims to the association that IBAC aims to establish between traditional Linux security and role-based access control, and role-based access control is then creating the association to type enforcement type security identifiers, and the type security identifiers are actually used to enforce integrity, and the role-based access control role security identifiers actually allow us to assign sets of or allow us to assign types to user identities using the identity security identifiers. And it's pretty complex, but later on I'll show you a graph that should make it a little bit more obvious. But basically the challenge to address is to govern access to one or more type enforcement type security identifiers using role-based access control role security identifiers. And additionally, it enables us to determine whether role-based access control role security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition if the above prerequisites are met using SELinux policy language, which we'll get into later. But yeah, just make a note of the fact that role security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition, or you can allow that basically. So this is one of the most important security models, I guess. Well, they all three default security models are equally important, but this is the main security model. Just like access vectors are basically the main security attribute that is used basically by every security model, type enforcement is basically the main s the security model that actually enforces integrity, and integrity is the main issue, the main challenge that SELinux addresses, a basic challenge that SELinux addresses. So enforce integrity of subjects by assigning TE type security identifiers to subjects and objects, and govern how subjects can interact with or operate on subjects or objects respectively by using access vectors provided by object managers, and additionally SELinux policy language policy rules. So these type security identifiers are associated to processes and system resources. These identifiers are created by us, and we can associate them to processes and system resources, and then we can basically specify rules that use the type security identifiers and access vectors to define whether some type security identifier can access another type security identifier in a way that an access vector allows us to specify that. Sorry. And then additionally, we can determine whether type security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition if the IBAC and role-based prerequisites are met. So, and that's also by using access vectors and SELinux policy language. So you have this concept of identify security identifiers, access vectors, security models that deal with particular challenges, and then the combination of these security identifiers and the access vectors enable us to basically govern how that should work. But type enforcement security model is basically the model that enables us to do the integrity on the system, fine-grained mandatory integrity, I guess. And then we have some optional security models, which we'll quickly discuss. Those are optional and additional, so they add an additional layer of constraints if you enable them. And we discussed that earlier, where we discussed the stack with on top the traditional Linux security, then the basic SE Linux, and then the optional additional SE Linux. And this is what the what I was referring to with the optional additional. This is an optional security model, and it's called user-based access control security model. And the challenge that it addresses, that it allows you to optionally and additionally compartmentalize specified subjects using user-based access control identity security identifiers. So the identity security identifiers are optionally also used by the UBAC security model to implement compartmentalization using those identity security identifiers. So with compartmentalization, I mean separation or isolation. Using additional policy constraints and access factors provided by object managers. So that compartmentalization is done using additional policy constraints and access and the access factors provided by object managers. So the access factors are really a central way to do things, and the object factors are provided by object managers. And the security identifiers, we can specify and associate, and the constraints are used to basically define that, how that works. Alrighty. Another optional security model is the multi-level security, multi-level access control security model, abbreviated MLS. Sorry. Again, so again, optional, additional, and MLS deals with the issue of confidentiality, and thereby also with compartmentalization. So. Confidentiality, basically that means govern the control of the flow of information in shared computer systems, dealing with the fact that different processes have different sensitivities, and dealing with the concept of need to know. So enforces confidentiality of subjects by assigning one or more MLS sensitivity security identifiers to subjects and objects, and enforce no read up and no write down using additional policy constraints and access factor provided by object managers, like always. So there's this rule that applies, and I already mentioned that, to the enforcement of sensitivities or confidentiality, is that the rule is of no read up and no write down. So there's this hierarchy of sensitivities, where you have a high sensitivity and low sensitivity and various sensitivities in between. And then there's the rule where they say you can't read up to higher sensitivities and you can't write down to lower sensitivities. And that basically allows for the control of the flow of control of the flow of information in shared computer system. But additionally, SE Linux enforces compartmentalization or need to know of subjects by assigning one or more MLS category security identifiers to subjects and objects using additional policy constraints and access factors provided by object managers. So additionally, so you're assigning, basically you're creating and assigning a sensitivity to a process and to files, and then there's this rule that says no read up, no write down, using policy constraints and access factors, and that allows you to control the flow of information, because these sensitivities have a hierarchy, where high sensitivities and low sensitivities. And then additionally, you'll use category security identifiers to actually enforce need to know by assigning categories to processes and files, and thereby compartmentalizing, isolating, or separating access to processes and files. Because if you have a category of, for example, company confidential, then you can access only processes and files with that same company confidential compartment. And that basically allows you to implement need to know, to enforce need to know. So enforce confidentiality, enforce the control of the flow of information in shared computer systems, and enforce need to know by compartmentalizing. And then additionally, you can use MLS to determine whether MLS security identifiers and MLS category security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition if identity-based access control and type enforcement prerequisites are met. We'll get into that later. The MLS and MCS security models are mutually exclusive because they interpret security level security attribute in different ways. So I'll just make a quick note of that we just discussed the MLS security model, but next we're going to discuss the MCS security model. And due to the nature of these two security models, they are mutually exclusive. And we'll get into that in the next slide in more detail. But just know that MLS and MCS are mutually exclusive security models. And they are that because they interpret the security level security attribute in different ways. So the last optional additional security model is called the multi-category access control security model, abbreviated MCS. So the challenge to address here is to only enforce need to know or compartmentalization of specified subjects by assigning one or more MCS category security identifiers. So it also uses category security identifiers, just like MLS does, to subjects and objects using additional policy constraints and access factors provided by object managers. So basically what it does, it uses the category security identifier to implement need to know for specified processes. Whereas multi-level security also uses the category security, but it uses security identifiers, but it uses it in a slightly different way, and it uses it in addition to sensitivity security identifiers. And multi-category security model doesn't use the sensitivity security identifiers. And basically, the combination of sensitivity security identifiers and category security identifiers are what's called a security level security attribute. So that's why they both are mutually exclusive, because MCS doesn't use the sensitivity security identifier. It only uses the category security identifier, whereas MLS uses both the sensitivity security identifier as well as the category security identifier. So since they both use the same security attribute, but in a different way, you can't implement them both, because that would conflict. So yeah, MCS basically enforcing need to know, and that's done by associating, by creating categories and associating categories to processes and files using identity-based access control. And then additionally determine whether MCS category security identifiers can manually change or automatically transition if IBAC and TE prerequisites are met. Okay. And that's that. Now, I have a graph that basically visualizes all this, but I guess we also need to talk about this chapter before we can get into that. So I'll leave that graph for the next bit.